it's a good thing that we do, and so we can get this started, so we come down and make the presentation. I'm going to ask the pool committee, Jay, and the pool committee, Gil and Don, who are here representing. I'm going to let Council Vice President Wong read the plot of what we are, but today, you know, I don't know what people know about our township pool or how things, where things were, but when I ran to come back for the empty seat that was available when Mr. Speckett stepped down, one of the things that when the council, that some of the council members had asked me to run, one of the things under the agreement that I said that I would run was we had to start to focus on the township pool. But there were some things in there that I thought was needed to be done and needed to be fixed and really looked at because I thought it was a township asset that we could utilize better and should be utilized better on that. One of the things that I think that we did also and helped to do that was form a pool committee, which Neil Ullman is the chair of. I got to sit on that committee, and along with Don and a few others. One of the things that we looked at was the things that were problems and the concerns that was going on with the pool. Well, some of those things were addressed. We have a heater now in the pool, and you know, I haven't heard too many kids complaining about how cold it is for swim lessons anymore, and you know, for dive team and whatever, and I think that's a great thing. And we had a phenomenal dive and swim program again this year, which is a great thing for all of us and for the town to kind of do to teach our kids how to swim, knowing some of the pitfalls we see with that. I want to thank this committee because they really have been able to see a vision of what they think needs to be done and where we can go. Without a vision, the vision that you need, though, is a leader. And as someone who runs the pool, who understands what we're looking for, what we're looking to do. And we were very fortunate that Jay came along, and we hired Jay to take over when our Mary retired. And basically at this point, you know, right now we're in a much better situation, and I'm going to let, you know, Mr. Council President Wong read this, and then you'll understand where we're going.
The 2017 Distinguished Facility Award presented to the Model Swim Club in recognition of your years of invaluable contributions to the activities and programs of the New Jersey Pool Managers Association by generously volunteering your facility for association events at the New Jersey Pool Managers Association.
So basically we got honored because of our management, which was exactly what we were looking for, and I think we had a new program, a new vendor for food this year with the Whistle Stop that was out of Waldwick that everybody raved about. And I think we did a great job there also with doing that. I think that was again led by our committee. And so we have a little resolution that we'd like to read on behalf of the township. Whereas the Township of Mahwah operates the Mahwah Swim Club on Darlington Ave, and whereas thanks to the efforts of Mr. Jay Esposito and his staff, the township received the 2017 Distinguished Facility Award from the New Jersey Pool Managers Association for the Mahwah Swim Club. And whereas the award is in recognition of the contributions the swim club staff and have made supporting the activities and programs of the New Jersey Pool Managers Association, and whereas the New Jersey Pool Managers Association is a nonprofit association dedicated to the enhancement and education of aquatic management and programs. Mahwah Swim Club received this award through a demonstration of outstanding leadership amongst a group of 45 among other aquatic facilities located in northern New Jersey. And whereas the swim club is specifically noted for hosting the Northern New Jersey Swimming and Diving Championship the past 3 years. This event is attended by more than 1,000 athletes and families. In addition, the Mahwah Swim Club has been the facility of choice for the association's members' meetings as well as for training and safety sessions throughout the summer. And whereas this award is also a reflection of the commitment that the township has made to enhance the Mahwah pool and evidence of what can be accomplished through hard work and passion. And whereas the township is proud of the facility and those who tirelessly work at the swim club, and now therefore be resolved that the Township Council, Mayor LaFerrette congratulated Mr. Jay Esposito and his staff on receiving the award and thanked them for their hard work. Congratulations. I will just say this. If you have not seen the township pool or been taking a look at it, what's going on, there are very good things happening. I really recommend that you take a look for next year and get yourself signed up because there are great things happening there. And I really do believe it is one of our assets that I thought was the most underutilized in this town. But I think what we're seeing happening now is that more and more people are starting to recognize that we have a pretty good thing there. So thank you. We have one more presentation that we're going to read, and we had asked the gentleman that we were doing this for because we've been trying to do 25 years of service for our employees here in town, of what they've done and dedication to our town. He's just squeaking in under the wire because he's leaving. So one of the things that we wanted to do before that happened was to recognize him. Unfortunately, he too has another commitment tonight. But we wanted to recognize one of our police officers, Charles Filatico, of his 25 years of service. So I'm just going to read a resolution on the record as Filatico has been involved with the PBA as the president. He's also been detective, on that. He may be serving as counsel right now in another town at this point tonight, which is where he may be, possibly. But like I said, I want to read this just to give you where we stand and what we believe for Jerry. Whereas the employees of Mahwah Township are vital resources and valuable community asset. Actually, you know what? Jim, you want to read this?
Yeah, you can read it.
No, you're...
opportunity to work with Jerry, I guess for over 15, 16 years with the police department. Jerry is a super guy. He was such an asset to the town, and being promoted recently to detective, it was just an honor to watch him get the badge. But I'll read this resolution. Whereas the employees of Mahwah Township are a vital resource and valuable community asset, and whereas the employees of Mahwah Township are an integral part of the fabric of our community, as such enhance the quality of life for all residents, and whereas the employees of Mahwah Township have consistently evidenced extraordinary dedication, service, and professionalism, and whereas Detective Gerald Filatico has loyally served the Mahwah Township Police Department for 25 years, and whereas Detective Gerald Filatico devoted service contributed significantly to the safety and well-being of Mahwah Township residents, and whereas Detective Gerald Filatico's commitment to professionalism extended beyond the department's high standards and was significant benefit to the fellow police officers. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Township of Mahwah Council of the Township of Mahwah and Mayor Bill LaFerrette congratulate and commend Detective Gerald Filatico for his 25 years of devoted service and extend our deepest appreciation and gratitude on behalf of all Mahwah Township residents. I hereby certify that this resolution, consisting of one pages, was adopted at a Township Meeting Council of the Township of Mahwah on this 12th day of October, 2017.
beginning of the month, so what we try to do here is what we also recognize what goes on in the month of October. Like I said, every month has got something going on, and so October is no different. So we're going to go through and read some of the resolutions and some of the things that we believe are important things to remember for about this month for some of the issues. 31-351-17, National Bullying Prevention Month. In 2010, National Bullying Prevention Month was formed due to the need to expand and educate. Each year, approximately 40% of students are estimated to be involved in some form of bullying. Communities and schools are encouraged to work together to stop bullying and cyberbullying. 352-17, National ADHD Awareness Month. Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder, ADHD, affects 11% of children between the ages of 4 and 17, and 4% of adults, that equates to 8 million people. It has been shown that those with ADHD are often sensitive to gluten, artificial dyes, and sugars. People with ADHD have many positive qualities, talents, and strengths. 353-17, this is a special to me because my mother and sister are both breast cancer survivors. National Breast Cancer Awareness Month. This was first observed in 1985 and sponsored by the American Cancer Society, and is now celebrated worldwide every October. Breast cancer targets both women and men. In 2009, several groups joined to establish the third week of October as Male Breast Cancer Awareness Week. The purpose of this month is to emphasize the importance of women and men to get mammography screenings at least every 2 years. And as you, my daughter was just cheerleading this past week, and they had their pink pom-poms and pink bows, and you see the kids and the boys and everyone. This is a big thing where they have wearing their pink socks and stuff for it. So, it's a big thing, and everyone should, get screened. 354-17, Domestic Violence Awareness Month. This month focuses on three key themes regarding domestic violence: mourning those who have died, celebrating those who have survived, and connecting with those who work to end domestic violence. Wearing the color purple during this month is a representation of effort to help fight against and end domestic violence. 355-17. I know this is very close to my clerk's heart, so this
she
is.
She would have brought hers with her, but she said.
Yeah, she would have brought hers with her, she said, but she's filthy. So, Adopt a Shelter Dog Month. The American Humane Society established this annual event in October 1981 to encourage people to save lives and enhance their own by adopting a dog from a shelter or rescue program. An estimated 3 to 4 million animals await adoption in shelters each year. To celebrate, everyone can adopt a pet. Spay or neuter your dog, ID your dog, or donate to your local shelter. We're going to adopt those now. Okay. So why don't we adopt 363 and 353 on the consent agenda? No, right? They're separate. Okay, so we're going to move 363, 350, through 355 right now. And can I get a motion on that? 363 is the follow-up. Right there, Janet.
Move it. Second.
Roll call.
Ms. Arima? Yes. Mr. Irvin?
Yes.
Mr. May?
Yes.
Mr. Sabara?
Yes.
Mr. Wong?
Yes.
Mr. Weishaupt?
Yes.
Mr. Hermanson?
Yes. Okay, that brings us to the public portion. Before we get to the public portion, I'm going to just want to say a few things because I think it needs to be warranted to be said of what's going on here in our township. I mean, some of the things that are happening. So I'm going to get some things off my chest because I've been sitting with these things, and I have to tell you, I've felt over the past week that this is one of the hardest weeks that I've ever had sitting here in this council as whether a councilman or a council president. So, we all know what's going on here in the town. We all know what has been asked of the council and through legal and whatnot, and what we are supposed to say or not supposed to say, and who we're supposed to talk to or not supposed to talk to. Unfortunately, there is an individual in this town who has decided that he is not going to abide by what people are being asked of him to do. I'm actually getting really tired of it because I'm tired of the emails, the phone calls. Do you see what he said next? Did you see this? Did you hear about this? Did you see what's in the newspaper? Did you see who was interviewed? Did you see where it came from? It actually is getting old and tired. Mahwa deserves better. The bottom line is very simple. We now have a Facebook post that was put out about a blatant lie about this town and the council, about a proposal that came before us for X amount of million dollars that was supposed to be done in a downtown. Well, I can tell you, I've been sitting on this council now for a number of years, and not once ever was that proposal made before this council. It was never brought to us. It was never came to our attention. And it was never stated that that was what we were looking to do or not looking to do. In fact, it never happened. It's fictitious. And I believe that the reason why this is happening is that there is a reason, a political motivation behind our mayor right now. And I don't believe that the mayor should be sitting on up here on the dais with a political motivation. If you're here to take care of the people, you're not here to take care of who you're pushing to run for election or what you're doing to go after. Mahwa residents deserve better. Mahwa residents deserve that the leader of this town does not lie to you on a consistent basis. I said to my son the other day over what was going on, and you know, he said to me, he goes, "Daddy, you know, I heard you say that he was lying. How do you know that he was lying?" I said, "It's simple. His lips are moving." Okay? And it's the truth. And I've had it. You know, I can't sit here on a dais and watch someone go in and disparage this town that you're representing week after week after week to the press. To go in and attack the council, to attack the people. The bottom line is we deserve better. The people deserve better. And I'm going to tell you, I'm not putting up with it anymore. I'm not putting up with this. It's not right. The mayor is not here on his own. We did not tell him not to come tonight or not show up or whatever. And I did let him know that when I had a conversation with him, that I was going to bring this up because I was tired of being taken advantage of, really, in a newspaper. That there, you know, he could basically say whatever he wants, think he can say whatever he wants to the people of this town, go and put it in there in writing, and then basically say, "Well, because I said it, it's true." Well, just because he says it, it's not true. It doesn't make it true. In fact, if he does say it, it's most likely a lie. Okay, at this point. And I'm done. I'm done with this. I'm not putting up with it any further. If this is the way he wants to do this and this is the way he wants to run the town, then we are going to run it the same way back. For every time he counters, says one thing about lying about the council is going to go back and show where he is and what he's done and how he's lying over this. It's that simple. So bottom line is there was never a proposal for the downtown. Never. The only proposal that was discussed, okay, and what was brought up and was floated was at a meeting that should never even been discussed in the first place because it was off a closed session meeting that he floated something. And he talked about a pilot program. So let everyone here understand what a pilot program means. Pilot program is payment in lieu of taxes. Payment in lieu of taxes means that the payment comes in directly to the township, that the council takes the money. The person who's doing the payment in lieu of taxes is given a tax break over the amount of time during that period where they get their taxes and it's paid up front. Therefore, over the 20 years or 25 years that they have it, they are that payment in lieu of taxes. It goes up front on a balloon payment. That balloon payment means that there is no money given to the Board of Education. So I want to make sure everyone understands that. It comes directly here. It bypasses anyone that goes through the Board of Education. If what he claimed to be built was built, and there were children that ended up in that development. Those children, over the time of that payment of lieu and taxes, were going to be paid for by somebody else to educate them, other than the person who had made their payment in lieu of taxes for the tax break. I don't believe that's right. I don't believe it's fair. And if it was a company coming in, it would be one thing where you're negotiating, because it's not going to be something that you're building on, you know, but children are coming in. But on the side, and we're not getting payment in lieu of taxes anyhow on that side. There's usually credits that are offered through the state and whatnot. But in the payment of lieu of tax on a building where you're potentially going to add high-density housing, which is what the mayor was looking for, again, density housing, which I am completely against, and so is this council. I believe on a 7-0 vote, we can tell you right now that there is not another person here that wants to see more high-density housing on this town. I believe it's time for the mayor to start acting like the mayor and starting to tell the truth. If he wanted a pilot program, he should say it straight, tell us what it is, and this way our people understand. I'm sure that if we were building more condos, which is what he was looking for, to go through the process of having children there, that there's not a person in this room that thinks that the way to do that is the right way, is to deny the education of the children who are potentially going to be in that building, or to afford it to put on the backs of the other taxpayers in this town in order to pay for the difference of that program. It's a disgrace. That being said, this public portion, each speaker shall now should be allowed to speak for 5 minutes. Before speaking, each speaker shall provide their name and address. Mahwah residents shall speak first. This public portion is limited to subjects on this agenda, and the public portion shall be a maximum of 30 minutes. Anyone willing to speak should come forward. I offer a motion to open the meeting to the public.
So moved.
Second. And Mr. Irvin, second.
Second.
By Mr. May. All in favor?
Aye.
This meeting is now open to the public.
Melanie Sue, 13 Grenadier Drive. Good evening to the governing body. I come before you today because I have been paying attention to what's happening in our town. I also pay attention to what's happening in neighboring towns and counties. I am a 13-year Mahwah resident, and my husband and I plan to raise our 3 children in this town. I'd like to voice my opinion tonight on 2 topics, lying and taxes. According to a document obtained via OPA request, in September of 2016, our chief of police notified our mayor and council of a meeting he had with the Hatzola Ambulance Corps. Hatzola is the ambulance service created for the care of the Hasidic community in Rockland County. It was stated in this letter from Chief Patelli that the Hatzola community, quote, believed it was important to discuss their services as they are planning to expand into North Jersey and more Jewish families move to Mahwah, end quote. So there you have it. The plan is to expand into North Jersey. Okay, fine. People need a place to live, and Mahwah is beautiful. I get that. Now fast forward to July of 2017 and the Eru, which I now live within. Mayor LaFerrette addressed a group of approximately 200 residents on July 24th, 2017, and he stated that he had no prior knowledge of the Eru. Why would our mayor state that he had no prior knowledge of the Eru? He clearly did. Why would our mayor then build upon that statement by reassuring citizens that an Eruv expansion does not indicate an Orthodox expansion? It clearly does. If a group of people wants to move to Mahwah, I don't need to question why. It is a beautiful place. However, if that same group of people has time and again been the catalyst in forever changing the landscape of neighboring communities, we need to be protective of our community to ensure we don't have the same fate. In order for Mahwah to even hope of getting along with a group that has desecrated the public services of neighboring communities, we first have to stop the lying. We have got to stop lying to ourselves, and we must demand that our town, county, and state officials stop lying to us. And I would like to propose that we become a proactive community rather than a reactive community. I know that the media will criticize this, but the media is not our friend lately, so who cares? If you know you are doing the right thing, it really doesn't matter what public opinion is. Whether we are proactive or reactive, the media will claim we're anti-Semitic. So let's disregard them altogether and be proactive. Which brings me to taxes. One of the ways we can be proactive in preserving this community is to adopt very strict laws with regards to tax exemptions. I strongly believe that if these laws are not in place, we will succumb to the landscape of our neighboring towns. I know why I moved to Mahwah, and it's not because I want to live amongst overdevelopment and poor schools. But if we choose to learn nothing from our New York neighbors and those residents of Lakewood, New Jersey, then shame on us. If you think that the corruption in Rockland County, New York, and Lakewood, New Jersey is a far-removed issue, please think again. What happens to a town when too many properties become tax-exempt? Simply put, you have less tax-paying properties. And in order to offset this, the remaining taxpayers will see their taxes go up. Do you know how many tax-exempt properties Mahwah has? According to the IRS, we have 121. Anyone care to take a guess how many exist in Muncie? The answer is 709. Here's a little food for thought. According to the IRS, the town of Lakewood, New Jersey, had 232 tax-exempt properties in the year 2000. Today, there are 972. That means the number of tax-exempt properties in Lakewood has increased by more than 400% in the past 17 years. Now this community is faced with being reactive. The question is, are we going to learn from them? Or are we going to allow the same thing to happen in Mahwah? I suggest we keep it reasonable here in Mahwah. We have an amazing school system, police force, and a fantastic DPW. All of these are funded by taxpayers. If the tax-exempt requirements are loose, let's tighten them. Anyone with the best interest of our town likely would not have a problem with tighter restrictions. But anyone looking to exploit our town is going to tirelessly look for loopholes. So let's close the loopholes. Thank you.
Let me start by saying I love Mahwah, which is why I'm sickened by the slanderous, insulting.
Frank, can you reach forward?
This is why I'm sickened by the slanderous, insulting, and false accusations written in the media, as well as the statements made at these council meetings by individuals who know nothing about the soul of this community. I thought I would see for myself firsthand how I would be treated by the community who has made so many negative comments about Mahwah. I traveled a few miles across the border to Rockland, New York. Here's what I found. My small group first stopped at a food market. Upon entering, the man behind the register said, "Can I help you? Are you buying anything?" I said I wasn't sure, and I proceeded to look around the store. When I came back with my purchases and I got on the end of the line, the same gentleman said, "Come, come." And, you know, made me go in front of three other customers in order to get me out of the store as fast as humanly possible. Based on his tone and demeanor, I surmised he didn't want me observing their business practices, possibly. Or, you know, maybe they weren't collecting sales tax, purchasing prohibited goods, using food stamps. I don't know. Maybe it was just my presence was bad for business. Next, we entered the town of New Square. I've heard many times and seen that many times this town is blocked to prevent entrance. I can't imagine that's legal. On this day, it wasn't blocked, so we drove in. Every few feet or so were signs designating which side of the street women could walk on and which side of the street men could walk on. Within 5 minutes of entering this town, we were followed by an individual in a black Honda. We were not simply followed. We were harassed and intimidated as this individual tailgated us, followed us in an aggressive manner, honking his horn. At one point, another vehicle in front of us stopped abruptly in the middle of the street and with no directional, proceeded to back up as if he was trying to park. He missed our car by less than an inch. The vehicle behind us was so close that we could not move in either direction. Both were loudly honking their horn and waving their arms as if we did something wrong. Finally, the car in front of us moved and we were able to proceed. The other car continued to follow us and pulled over to the side of the road where he eventually passed us, raced at a high speed into a driveway around the corner and entered a home, presumably to alert others of our presence. We decided it was time to leave. We stopped and asked a few people for directions and we were ignored as if we didn't exist. Our last stop was a children's park in the town of Curious Joel, and the hypocrisy is stunning. The park was large with modern, expensive-looking play equipment. The New York Times named Curious Joel, quote, the poorest town in America. In Curious Joel, 70% of the residents live below the federal poverty line. 50% receive food stamps, and a third are on Medicaid. One must question how the poorest town in America could possibly afford to build and maintain a park like this and claim they did it without using any state or federal funding. Similar to the town streets, the park is segregated with a boys' side and a girls' side, clearly in violation of state and federal laws. In fact, the American Civil Liberties Union sued Curious Joel and won a lawsuit in New York State Supreme Court because of this violation. The reason they won is the town refused to produce any evidence that federal and state funds were not used to build or maintain the park. At the entrance to this park is a large metal barrier preventing anyone from entering the park. Surrounding the play area itself is a 10-foot fence topped with barbed wire with brick turrets in the corners of the park. It resembles more of a prison than a children's park. In front of the fence is a building with the words "Security" written in large red block capital letters. At the park entrance is another large, expensive sign stating that the park is for town residents only and directs non-residents to other parks in other towns where they list them by name. Next to this sign is a smaller sign listing some common sense rules, such as no barbecue, no smoking, no open flames. I guess they don't want to damage their property, but feel it's okay to go into other towns and destroy theirs. I believe the only reason we were not physically removed from this park was because we never entered the play area behind the fence, and that we arrived before the park was fully, you know, operational. In summary, the group I was with were subjected to harassment, intimidation, sexism, profiling, intolerance, and legal violations that far exceed everything Mawa has been falsely accused of. Last week, our mayor equated the town council remedies to, quote, poking the stick in the eye of state officials. I disagree, and from what I've observed, this council has attempted to enforce laws, many of which have been on our books for years. The council has been prudent and attempted to take every step to ensure sure our ordinances are fair to everyone, do not target any single group, and will stand up to legal challenge. A wise judge in New York once said, quote, "You can indict a ham sandwich if that's what you really want to happen." You know, right now, the time to defend our rights of all township residents is not simply back down to false accusations. If we do not attempt to enforce violations of our laws now, when? We'll be sitting here in a few years asking ourselves, what happened to our town? In the words of the late, great Tom Petty, "I won't back down, and you should either."
I find it ironic that members of the public are taking pictures of these photos, but the members of the press aren't. Mr. Noble, may I suggest that you take your editor, Alfred Doblin, up to these areas where this gentleman just talked about, and maybe do a little expose on what's going on up there, and stop, tell him to stop knocking the township of Mahwah.
I live at 24 Island Road in Mahwah and grew up in Muncie, New York. For the record, I lived at 6 Darby Road in Muncie for 21 years and graduated from Spring Valley High School in the 90s. If anyone has any questions about my ethnic background, I'm Filipino-American, adopted by Irish-Americans, have a South Indian sister, and am married to a Peruvian with whom I have 4 children. I was raised with diversity and acceptance, qualities which drew my husband and me to Mahwah over 20 years ago when we started our family. In addition to the excellent schools, real estate, various houses of worship, and beautiful parkland, the wide variety of welcoming, community-minded residents are one of Mahwah's greatest assets. That being said, I am here to address, the mayor, but I see he's not here. Anyway.
Well, he should be not here even when he's here, so that's all right. You can
ask him. I have specific points to say to him, so should I just direct them to you?
Sure,
guys?
Sure.
Okay. Council and those in attendance, because the negative labels against our township must cease immediately. I am also here to urge my fellow residents to not buy into any type of verbal or written baiting by the media, to avoid word games with out-of-towners that have nothing better to do than attend Mahwah Council meetings, and to refer any inquiries to our township attorney. Having grown up in Muncie, I have witnessed Muncie's culture and vibe contribute to its population growth. It has been well documented that Muncie wants to expand its geographical footprint. An expansion of Muncie would not only result in addition of square mileage, an expansion of Muncie would also result in the expansion of a lifestyle that would exclude the people that live in existing neighborhoods. The point of my conversation here is to remind every Mahwah resident in attendance and watching the live stream, we live in Mahwah and contribute to the community because the quality of life that currently exists in this town works for the 25,000 plus people that live here. Last time I checked, we live in the township of Mahwah, not the Democratic People's Republic of Korea. Everyone here in attendance is a free-thinking human being entitled to thoughts and ideas of their own. As human beings, we have the right to agree to disagree with one another. I am glad Mahwah took a step in the right direction since the last council meeting by passing an ordinance limiting door-to-door solicitation without a permit and updating the park ordinance to prevent negative acts and behaviors in our public parks by all users, regardless of where they reside. I really wanted to remind the mayor about some of the negative behaviors that have occurred in our township recently, because I think he needed his memory refreshed. So I just wanted to tell him that Mahwah residents have witnessed and recorded things such as out-of-state vehicles speeding through township cul-de-sacs, intimidating families and children on those streets, large groups of out-of-town residents congregating in our parks and not cleaning up after themselves, and people having an open-flame barbecue on a brand-new $1,200-plus taxpayer-funded township picnic table and burning a hole in it. Mayor and Council, please understand, I am a township resident that disagrees with the behaviors and desires of non-residents that want to establish a footprint in Mahwah and want us to fully accept their thoughts and ideas without an open-minded discussion. And let me make it 100% clear here. Just because I disagree with what these non-residents want to do in the township of Mahwah does not mean I am racist, bigoted, or anti-anything. I am simply not understanding. What is important to note is that there are other town residents who feel the same way as I do. Period. End of story. So for our mayor to continuously engage the media for his own purposes and to not respond to the inaccurate labeling of our town, let's see, we've been called anti-Semitic, bigoted, racist, etc., is reprehensible and certainly not Mahwah-minded. Mayor Laferrette was elected to best represent the interests of his constituents here in Mahwah, maintaining the high standards of our school district, keeping the integrity of our infrastructure, instituting and enforcing ordinances and zoning laws that enhance the fabric of life in our town. That's what he needs to be focused on. If he has political aspirations beyond that of a mayoral post, I demand that he works with the town council and chief of police to protect the quality of life in Mahwah here and now. Mayor needs to know he is in control of his political legacy. And I would like to know, unfortunately he can't answer this evening, Mayor, what will your footnote say? That you did your very best to keep Mahwah an open and secular town, or that he was impossible to work with and sold his constituents down the river in the name of the almighty dollar? So the choice is his. Mahwah needs Mayor Laferrette to do the right thing. Thank you.
Interesting the past few weeks reading the article in the record saying that town council passed an ordinance banning out-of-state residents. That's what was stated a couple weeks ago. From what I remember, maybe my, getting old, getting to be 50, my memory's not as good as it used to be, an ordinance was introduced and it was tabled, correct?
One that was introduced, it was passed, but not be enforced.
Okay.
It can't be enforced.
So it can't be enforced. So I don't know what the story is. It's not being enforced. No one's saying not to have out-of-town residents come in. It's to behave like civilized people. That's all everybody wants. Not to burn a table and say, oh, we can see the sign. Are you kidding me? So someone who owns an open flame does not know that, hey, if you put it on plastic, it's going to melt. I'm sorry. The instructions are there. I'm sure it says somewhere, have to put it on a surface, that it's not going to melt. Somewhere along the line, it must be there in the instructions. And seeing all the things that were banned in the recent ordinance, what's not to be done in the park, I would like to know what is so anti-Orthodox, anything there that was listed. It is common sense. Thousands and thousands of towns throughout this country and throughout this world have those same type of restrictions. And it's just to protect the property and the taxpayers, whether they live in the town, in this county, or the state, or the country, wherever there is throughout the world, to keep it in one piece. That's all there is to it. So, When the press comes out there and says everything anti-thing, take a look at your own town where you live in and look at those ordinances and see how much different they are than the ones in Lalo. Thank you.
Just one second, please. I just want to make sure I get the time or whatever here, but Mr. Doblin wrote the other day about one of the ordinances. Okay, so I'm just going to address that just as more of an understanding. I think the comment was about leaning a bike against a tree. Has he ever met Councilwoman Arima? There's not a tree that she hasn't met that she hasn't hugged. Okay? So if they're going to deface or potentially deface anything, we put that in there just strictly for her. Okay? So, you know, I find it odd that when we start to see some of the things that are going on around here in this town and the things that are commented on and attacked, that we're attacked over, I do find it kind of comical at this point that they have nothing else better to write about. My father once told me that when someone else in the here has nothing else better to do than to worry about your life, to talk about you, means that they must be living a pretty boring life. But I gotta tell you, the Bergen Record must be a pretty boring place, and all they have to worry about is Mahalo.
First, did you give Kathy your rate yet?
Not yet, but we did give you one earlier this year. So.
Good.
We knew it was going to happen. That's what we kind of figured, I guess. You know, we made an adjustment,
right? You know, when I first started to get involved with all of this stuff, I was really thinking about how corrupt the mayor is and all these different things. And what I realize now is he lacks the intelligence to be even that corrupt. And what he is a puppet. And the more you research and look and dig into his history, he's a puppet to Sam Aparicio and Telly, and he's a puppet to Jim McQueen and to the group around him. And Politico came out with an article that, or quote, that Jim McQueen is being considered for Phil Murphy's, they call it a cabinet or whatever, when and if he wins the governorship. And the idea being that because they're all so chummy with my friend Todd Scherer from the planning board, it's very clear to me that there's a group there and a lot of concern. My question to the council is, at what point is there enough information in front of you where somebody does an investigation into seeing what's actually going on here? Because at the end of the day, Todd Scherer works on cash-based hit funds. Okay. At the same time, the people purchasing a lot of the land in Mahalo are hedge funds. And he's the chairman of the planning committee in Mahalo and also on the Urban Housing and Development Board in Bergen County. I'm sorry, but that's way too many dots connecting. I mean, you also consider the fact of this man was basically booted out of Paramus when his boss was arrested and thrown into prison, and was told to come to Mahalo with the intention of increasing the Democratic presence in Mahalo. Well, why? Well, Democratic presence would mean people more in favor. Millennials tend to be, statistically, tend to be Democrats. So the more Democrats they have in the town, the more chance that they have of being able to get a Democratic elected council. Therefore, they can get the zoning laws changed, and therefore they can proceed with their agenda. That's why I think it's so important that Republicans win. In November, not because of what the nudniks that are getting paid off by Ben Sorian and all those folks are thinking that my intention of writing what I do about Republicans needing to win is weird because I'm a lifelong Democrat. Truth is, it's embarrassing being a lifelong Democrat at this point. I just want to basically leave it with the questions to the council, really two questions. The first is, what does it take for, well, I don't even know if it's in your power, but what does it take for you guys to put in a legitimate investigation into Todd Scherer, to put in an investigation into the relationship the mayor has? See, the reason the mayor never says anything at council meetings is because he can't think of anything to say. He has to wait until Jim McQueen that night tells him what to say the next day on his favorite television show. So that relationship is like we're supposed to pretend like it doesn't exist, like we're idiots. Well, I'm sorry, I'm not going to let that happen anymore. And I want to look as far as speak because otherwise it'll hurt me. No.
Yeah.
Mr. Ryback, this board does not have any power to open up any investigations on any citizens, taxpayers, head of planning boards, and such. The only people that can actually do that is the Attorney General's office, and I think they're a little too busy with other stuff to go after those people.
Interesting, because the AG is also friends with Todd Sherrod, Jim McSweeney, and also our friend Alfred Dolman and all the other media people. By the way, the last thing I want to... Two very quick things. The first is, I've written to Alfred Dolman several times, email, Twitter, and I would like to publicly tell you what I've asked him. I've challenged him to a debate live, moderated by a third party between he and I. And if he's actually wants to man up and show up, I'm ready.
He's here. Where is he?
Hey, come over here, Dolman. Get free. You want to stand by everything you always say? Not here?
He's here.
Please.
He said he's here.
He wouldn't be. He's probably boozing for me. Let me leave you with this thought, everybody, because this is a quote I'm going to read regarding Lakewood, New Jersey. More than 20,000 youngsters attend private tuition-based kindergarten through 12th grade yeshivas, whereas 6,000 children, mostly African-American and Latino, attend public schools. But because the Hasidim do not permit boys and girls to sit together, the township has long provided gender-separate courtesy busing for all pupils, a major factor in the public school district's current $12 million deficit. Schools are paid for based on property value, not the amount of kids you have. So if you have two or three kids, or you have 12 to 14 kids, you pay the same amount based on one thing. So it sucks the system dry, and I just wanted to piggyback on what everyone else was saying with that comment.
Well, I just want to add something, okay? Because I tell you this was a very difficult week for me. I'm going to share something personal, and maybe, you know, not going to go so personal on where I am or what's going on, but this past week, I heard from my wife that she was addressed where she works, that an individual walked up to her desk and stated that the mayor of your town believes that your husband is an anti-Semite. My wife came in and said, how embarrassing to our family and to our kids that you're being called an anti-Semite. You have no idea what that did to me and my kids. It's wrong. It's so wrong. I've had to live with that, knowing what my wife was said by somebody as an employee to her because of my mayor, because of something that he's attacked this council and attack this town over, that's being pushed in a paper that is absolute garbage. And you know what? I now have to go home and look at my wife in the eye and my kids, knowing that this is what she's hearing in her job, in her employment. It's disgusting. I won't put up with it. And I'm not putting up with it anymore with him, because it will not come into my house anymore, not because of him, not because of the paper, and not because of anyone else in this town who doesn't think that we're doing the right thing for this town to protect the town. It's that simple. It's rules, it's our laws, that's it. It's not what it's about his agenda or anything else. And I'm getting tired of being castigated over things that are just absolutely not true to embarrass me and my family.
I agree with you. First of all, I'm not sure he knows what an anti-Semite is. Probably have to explain it to him. But or give him a spell it or something. But the thing is, I think what's important to point out is it's not just him, because he's a puppet. It's people behind him. And you don't have to look any further than his relationship with the media, Jim McQueenie's relationship with the media, to understand that we have to dig deeper than that, than the mayor, because he's just a puppet to these people. And I know that from what I've written about. But we need more ordinances. I send you all a sheet that I've recommended ordinances that I truly believe need to be in Brian's hands and turned into ordinances. And as Melanie said before, we don't care what people think. It's for us, not for the newspaper. So anyway, thank you very much. Appreciate it. needs to go. And we have, looks like, one more speaker, and then I'm we're going to have two more speakers after this, and then we're going to close the portion until the next one, okay?
Lisa DiGiulio, 6 West Road. I'm here because of all the stuff in the paper, and I just wanted to clarify the way this whole thing came about. When this was put up, who knew about it? When your rooms went up? Did administration know? Who first got the first thing that they were up?
Well, when they were up. I think we found out well after the fact that they were up.
Well, and that's the problem. This was all handled very, very poorly. But we got a newsletter this week, and it's very interesting. I'm going to read something about this newsletter that I think is going to clarify a lot. It's under prohibited signs. And I just bear with me to read this. A sign is defined as any device for visual communication that is used for the purpose of bringing the subject thereof to the attention of the public. The public is reminded that the following signs are prohibited in the township. Now, nowhere in that definition does it say it has to have verbiage. It said it's a device. That's number one. Signs limiting official traffic control devices or signs. Signs which are obstructing doors, windows, sidewalks, driveways, or streets. Signs placed on trees, rocks, or utility poles. Searchlights or beacons. Banners, pennants, streamers, bunting, balloons, gas-filled figures, or similar devices. Except as specifically approved by the council of the Township of Monmouth, provided under the ordinance. Portable or A-frame signs, advertising, flashing, moving, projecting, or rooftop signs. Signs affixed on park motor vehicles, the primary purpose of which signs is to direct the attention of the public to any business or activity conducted on the premises and park the vehicle is parked. Signs placed in the public right-of-way or on public property without first obtaining approval of the Township Council. Then this last statement is very interesting. The Township has always and will continue to take the enforcement of these regulations very seriously. Based on what was written here, I am asking, really demanding, that those things come down. Court and so be it. Yeah. However, the sign ordinance was in effect many, many years ago. This didn't just happen overnight. My problem is when they went up, who knew about it? Were those the people breaking all laws? Yeah. The people who put them up, but the people who knew about them going up. Now, this bottom line says the township has always. I don't care about what the newspapers write. I don't care what anybody writes, because if I wanted to put a wreath up there, I wouldn't be able to. And that doesn't have any verbiage either, but it is a symbol, and we all know that. This is all symbols. Let them wear it on their head when they walk around, but not on the utility poles, because we have an ordinance. Let my wreath go somewhere else, because it shouldn't be on the utility poles. And the other question I have, Rockland Electric gave them permission and put them in a safety issue. Because where they have them, there are no sidewalks. Yeah. Are we now going to have to pay for sidewalks? Bull crap! The employers have to pick up on all of this stuff that they think is anti-Semitic and anti-this and anything else. We have every religion and every nationality in this town, and we have lived peacefully and wonderfully in this town and established a great way of life. And anybody's welcome to our way of life, but they're not going to change our way of life.
Don't you love following her?
Michelle Mary, I live 10 away at Crown Court. I've been in this town for 20 years. I was the bank manager of Hudson United, right next to Sunoco. So I know the left rights very well, personally. Politically, I'm not happy. I want to know from council, how do we get help? What do we have to do? What steps do we have to take to get this and to save our town?
Well, I'm going to answer this as best I can.
Send it to the attorney.
The attorney can tell you what can be done and how it's done, but it's not going to get done by this council. Because the one thing that I believe is that it should never be political. It should be driven by what the people in the town think.
So how do the people do it?
But that's, I think, will be up to the, that's what the attorney can tell you what the policy, how it works or whatever. But I will just tell you that it will not, there's no one, I think, on this council who should push it or to try to, force or say, this is, to run with it or whatever. If you agree with it, you can say you agree with whatever, that's fine, it's your own opinion. But, there's things you have to sign, you may want to sign, that's fine. But for us, it will not come from the dais, because I don't think that's the right thing to do.
How much time does it have left? 2 years?
3 years and change.
We're in trouble.
Well,
you realize that we're in trouble.
You would like to say, but...
Yeah, the only remedy with regard to a sitting elected official is to follow the procedures of the recall statute, which is...
You need a microphone.
The microphone. Which is a petition.
That was good.
Which requires a petition process. So if you have a significant number of signatures, that would be presented to the clerk. If it's certified, there would be an election. There's a recall election. It's like yes or no. Do you wish to recall or not?
Yes.
Now my recollection is that there was a recall effort a while ago. So you're only allowed to do it within certain periods of time. And it depends when the person was elected and how many years they have left.
Or there is a second possibility, but I can guarantee you he'll never go by door number 2, which is by him doing it himself. So just going to say that, just on the right there. So there is 2 possibilities, but I can almost guarantee that's never going to be a possibility. So
thank you.
Richard Canalo, 16 Davidson Court, Canalo, New Jersey. I had written some comments and some questions, but I'm just going to speak, I guess. I've been a resident of Mawa for the amazing 3 months that I've been here.
Long way in a better time.
Prior to this, I lived in Woodbury, New York, and was part of the Monroe Woodbury Central School District, and was a volunteer with United Monroe, and sat on the board, technically still sit on the board of directors of Preserve Pleasant Valley. I was forced out of my home. That's a story I won't get into here. And we chose Mawa. Oh. And it was about a week after we moved in when the story of the year hit the papers. I guess I was kind of numb to it. I think it's a distraction. I think that overall, it's a tactic. And the more attention we pay to it, and the more stock we put in it, and the more it gets a rise out of us, the more they're winning. Everything that is important now is basically sitting in front of us, and that is all of you. And the people who elect you are us. So I urge everyone to vote. I urge everyone in this room and anyone watching on Facebook Live to listen to people who are paying attention when we tell you who you should vote for, and then make sure you tell your neighbors and that they tell their neighbors and that everybody vote. We were extremely unsuccessful in United Monroe having any effect on the village of Curious Joel at all until we formed a block vote. It was around the time when we were able to send about 3,500 people to the voting polls that the county executive started showing up to our meetings, and then the county legislatures, and then the assemblymen and assemblywomen. And all of a sudden, we had a voice. When I left United Monroe, we had around, and I think they have now, almost around 7,000 votes that they can just send to the polls. They were successful in sitting at the table and negotiating a truce over the illegal land annexation from the town of Monroe into Curious Joel. And there will be a vote on November 4th or 7th, whatever it is, whether or not the town people want that or not. I cannot tell you how hard it was to get there. I can tell you stories that would make your head spin. It was a lot of effort. It was a lot of long hours. I have a full-time job. I run a company. I have two kids. It drained me. So here I am again. I told my wife I wasn't going to get involved.
Well, ditto. All right, yeah. Guess what?
I can't help myself. I wanted to move to Mahwah 5 years ago before we moved to Woodbury, and I couldn't afford it at the time. Couldn't afford what I wanted within Mahwah. I'm lucky enough now to have been able to, and I'm not going anywhere. I'm going to raise my family. This may feel right now insurmountable. It may seem overwhelming. There's a lot of emotion. I urge everyone to breathe. This is not insurmountable. We hold all the cards. We currently have all the votes. We have ordinances that either are put in place, hopefully somewhere that will be put in place. We have to watch our zoning. We have to be diligent. We have to be focused. But all the most important thing is that we remain unified as a town. If we are for the preservation of this town and for transparency in government, and that is what we stand for, there's nothing discriminatory about that. Okay? I'll say one more thing. Because I was on the board of directors there and I was involved in several lawsuits, we were successful in garnering 1,600 votes out of the village of Curious Joel in support of our cause. Okay? These were lovely people of faith, Hasidic people of faith, who believed in what the Talmud actually preaches, which is assimilation and getting along with your neighbor. Okay? So do please be careful about painting any broad strokes. And I'm not looking at any one person or anyone up on the dais. But be very careful to paint broad strokes of a culture that no one in this room really knows too much about. There is an upper class faction of this culture that tells people what to do. It's an oppressive culture. But that is not the fault of those being oppressed. And I will say that I've had lovely conversations and experiences with people of the Hasidic faith. So it's not a problem of religion that we're dealing with. It's a problem of greed. It's a problem of wanting to impose your will upon other people, even though they may not agree with it. It's not right, but as I said earlier, we can, if we remain together and we vote every year, and you vote and you vote and you get everyone to the polls, you can remain in control and this town can prosper. I believe that wholeheartedly. So thank you to all of you for what you're doing. Please, whatever ordinance you can pass, if there's no discriminatory language in them, do not let the media or anyone else dictate what you do. Go about your business and get it done.
Kids, to residents, of what goes on. If
I don't get back fast enough to somebody on an email, they get mad at me, even though I have other things in life with a job and kids and a wife to take care of. Okay, actually she takes care of me. But the bottom line is that we have a lot going on. And we're doing this because we love this town. We all may have a different way of doing things or coming about it from a different way. But I can tell you that I do not ever question anyone's heart or desire of what they're trying to do for this town who is currently sitting up here on this dais. And you know what? I like this council. This is a good council. These are good people. I'm tired of the attacks. I'm tired of people telling us of what we're going to do to make it better or who we are or what goes on. Let me tell you something. Let them come in here and walk a mile in my moccasins just one day right now of what we've gone through. Trust me when I tell you. I've had phone calls to my office attacking me for my job, going after my job, okay? I have had people here going in and attack my family, to attack my kids, my wife, me, okay? My sisters don't even live in this town. It's a joke. What's gone on? For what? Because we're sitting up here to try to protect our town, the integrity of our town, what we are, the style, the belief of what we want to have for our town, what the residents want, because that's who we're listening to come up here. You're absolutely right. You got involved because it's what you wanted to do to protect the fabric and the environment of your town there. We all did the same thing. And I'm going to tell you, so long as I sit in this dais, for however long that is, okay, I promise you, I will continue to protect this town. I don't care what anyone says. They can attack me, my family, or wherever else, when they can attack the members of this council. But if they attack the members of this council, they attack me. And I'm sorry, this is Mahwah. We deserve better. This is the meeting place. And you know what? And so is this room, which is the reason why you're all here. And I want you to remember, Mahwah is great. Mahwah is not great because of the people who are sitting on this dais. Mahwah is great because of the people who are in that crowd, the people who are watching on streaming, and the people who can't come out, but who are there who live in this town. Dick Martell taught me something a long, long time ago. You didn't have to be in the newspaper. You didn't have to take credit for anything. You didn't need to be patted on the back. When you did something good, Mahwah got credit for it, not the council. Okay? Until that starts going back that way, where you have leaders here that want to have got the credit for themselves, but have the town to be credited and have a pat on the back for this town, there will continue to be articles and negative ads about this town in newspapers, on the patch, and wherever, because it is usually the person who is putting the interview together who is the one who is starting what's going on around here. So all I'm saying is very simple. It's time for us to move forward as a community. Do the right thing. You're absolutely right. Everyone does have to vote. You have an opportunity in November to move this community one way or the other. And you have that right. And I hope that everybody, and I implore everybody in this town to follow their civic duty and to vote for the candidates that they believe is the right thing for Mahwah. Thanks.
Second.
By Mr. Wong. All in favor?
Aye.
This meeting is now closed to the public.
Take a
5-minute break. Yeah. Oh, yeah.